Hey, Mitch, I am so honored to have you back on the Digital Slice podcast. How are you?
Brad, I'm doing great. You just made my whole week. Seeing your smiling face, it's been way too long, and it's really good to be able to spend some time with you and your community. So I'm doing well, my friend. How are you doing?
Good. I'm doing great. I'm doing great. And it's nice to see your smiling face too. You
Good.
know, the last time that you were on the podcast, we were talking about how important it is to create video and the trust and credibility that you create when you're creating video and how that helps you grow your business. And we talked about how you're a early adopter. At that time, it was live video, and it's been a few years. I've been following you on all the social media platforms
Stop,
and
stop. We don't fo we
elsewhere.
don't, we don't
And
follow each other. We're buddies on the digital platforms. We engage all the time,
that's
and
right.
that's the way
That's
I
right.
look at it, Brad.
But it looks to me that being an early adopter hasn't really changed. So what are you up to these days?
What am I up to? I think, okay, you may be alluding to Web3 and the metaverse. And so what we're up to is still a full-time trial lawyer, Brad, 35 years. I still enjoy rolling out of bed, love to help clients. I'm more excited today than I've ever been before about practicing law. Having said that, one of the reasons I think I have this mindset and I've been able to build this life and this profession that works for me, okay, is because I like bringing in new things into the practice of law. For example, Brad, and you'll remember these days, and it's going to date you and I, but
Uh-oh.
I remember being one of the first law firms to have what was called a fax machine, right? And all my buddies around town, what are you doing? What is this thing? How do you use it? Fast forward to, oh, I don't know, maybe something called the internet and websites and bulletin boards and social media. Video, live video, fast forward to what we're doing today with social audio and everything else in between. It's kept doing business. It's kept practicing law interesting for me, right? Because I'm interested in technology and this kind of stuff. So, having said all that, Brad, what we've done over the last year and a half, and it's kind of because of the pandemic and people accepting remote interactions, for example, with professionals and business owners, whether it's on Zoom, StreamYard, or something else, how we've been appearing in court using video and live video is because of faster internet connections like 5G, home high-speed connections. It's because of consumer mindsets where they expect us to be available on platforms and in places where they are. It's because of all of these reasons. To answer your question, you can't expect a short answer, okay, from a lawyer, Brad. But to circle back to your question, we're all in and spending a lot of our time right now when I'm not in the courtroom with Web3 platforms, blockchain, smart contracts, a little bit with NFTs, and a lot with the metaverse and metaverses. So right now we're doubling down on Web3 and metaverse platforms because all the other technologies I just mentioned. In fact, why don't we throw in the printing press, electricity, and the wheel? I think what we're experiencing right now in real time with Web3 and the metaverse, and I mean this, I'm serious about this, I think it's 100x everything I just mentioned when it comes to how society will be communicating, how our communities will be interacting, how businesses and professionals will be delivering their products and services. I think we're experiencing in real time a changing of the guard, shall we say, when it comes to all of the above, and it's Web3 and the metaverse. So that's where you find me. That's where you find a lot of my friends right now, learning as much as we can, meeting with clients in metaverse platforms, and really embracing this technology. So 5 years from now, when we look back, we're going to feel like, okay, we're way ahead of the curve instead of just a couple of steps ahead of the curve in 2022.
Well, I'm relieved to say that many of the things that you just ticked off are things that are in my notes to talk to you about
Oh,
today.
good, good.
And I am sad to admit that I am familiar with that fax machine. And on that same line, though, I was just having a conversation with a buddy of mine a week or so ago. What we were talking about was how back in that same time frame, FedEx became a thing. And it used to be that every day at 10 o'clock, FedEx would deliver and we would drop everything and run out to get that message that had to be so important in that FedEx envelope, the contract or the settlement agreement or whatever it was that you had to have the original signatures on, and how FedEx was a big thing too. Yeah, we would drop everything for that fax.
Next day delivery, right?
Yeah.
Next day delivery. Yeah.
It's crazy. I think my doctor actually still uses a fax machine for what they claim is security reasons.
You know, it's interesting. The technology, we use e-fax, so it's digital fax, and it works really well. And mm-hmm. a lot of clients and lawyers are very comfortable with using that type of technology, and so that works. But you just mentioned something with FedEx, Brad, and I think this is what people need to wrap their head around is, for me, I had a client call, hey, Mitch, can you, and this is probably what, back in the mid-80s, I think, is the first time that I used the service, the FedEx service. Maybe it was UPS. I don't remember which one. Yeah. Next day delivery service. I remember a client saying, can you next day me those 300 pages of jury instructions? I need them on my desk. I need to go over them with my board of directors, right? Whatever it was. And I thought to myself, you know, whatever happened to putting something in the mail, 5 to 7 days later, the other side receives that snail mail. That's the way we all used to do business before next day delivery and before the fax machine. Fast forward a couple of years from then, everyone was expecting next day deliveries. Everyone was expecting you to be able to immediately send a fax. I think where we are today when it comes to Web3, the technologies I alluded to earlier in the metaverse, I think in a couple of years, Brad, everyone will be expecting that option to be offered by, you know, a company, by a law firm, by a professional. And there's a good reason why every single Fortune 500 company is investing in Web3 and metaverse technology. You know, you don't need to be the brightest bulb in the lamp to figure out when corporations are spending tens of millions of dollars to build a footprint using these technologies, when you've got some of the top entertainers and athletes and companies on the planet building out virtual spaces. That kind of tells you maybe there's something here that we all need to pay attention to. And just like next day delivery that you mentioned earlier, that's what we're seeing today. And we're doing everything we can each and every day to try to stay one or two steps ahead of our competition with building out our brands in these spaces so that we can better serve our clients and we can create those exemplary client experiences that other law firms aren't creating. And I'll tell you something, over the last year and a half, I'm really glad that we're doing this because it's been received very well, Brad. And so hopefully people will supplement or substitute next day delivery with the term Web3 and metaverse, and they'll be off to the races, right?
Right, right. So why don't you give us a definition of Web3 and a definition of the metaverse so that we have some foundation for our continuing discussion?
Sure. You know, I was just holding up my car. I just saw this reflection, Big Daddy. So our daughter has a COVID, before we talk about that, let me talk about the important stuff.
Yes.
Our daughter has a COVID puppy. She bought about a year ago. Mm-hmm. Her name's Ruby May, and she's a dachshund, just the cutest little wiener dog in the world. And AJ refers to me as Ruby's Big Daddy. So that's the coffee cup I got for Father's Day, for those of you watching the video. So my take, and this is from an entrepreneur, a business owner, a lawyer's perspective, okay? No coding, no technology. Web3 is simply the next iteration of social media, the way I'm looking at it, of the web. It's a decentralized approach to, instead of a platform being owned by one company, it's decentralized. It's shared across hundreds and thousands of servers around the world in an ideal environment. Now, I'm not sure if the decentralized approach to Web3 is really going to work because the metaverse platforms that we're using in Web3 environments actually are owned and operated by by single companies, right? And so I'm more focused on the ultimate experience that Web3 and the metaverse provides to me and to my clients and opposing counsel and expert witnesses. But having said that, it's a more interactive use of the internet premised upon or built upon a proposed decentralized foundation. Okay, that's Web3. The metaverse, as I look at it, is simply a virtual extension of our firm, of who we are. So Brad, if you are a potential client and I said, listen, let's set up a meeting and fix the problems that you're having right now. My team would say, Brad, would you like to talk to Mitch, you know, on the phone, email, text, private messaging on Instagram, private video, or would you like to meet in our virtual office space, virtual conference room? If there's more than one of you, if there's 10 people that want to meet with me. And so we put these options out there. And what we do is we send a private link, this password protected, where you click on it and you join us in a beautiful conference room, you know, better than anything that you could imagine. It's just a 10 out of 10 when it comes to graphics. And it feels like you're in a real conference room with private laptop screens in front of each person sitting at the conference table, a big whiteboard up front. I can display movies, videos, 3D objects, whatever it might be within this conference room. And you can access this room from your smartphone, your tablet, your laptop, your desktop, or the best experience, because it improves the quality of the experience by about 95%. It feels like you and I are in this space together using a compatible headset, maybe an Oculus Quest 2, about $300. It integrates with all the top metaverse platforms. And you're good to go. So what I found is it's a virtual extension of what we're doing right now in an environment that allows anyone from around the world to engage with us in a very professionally intimate way. Have you had the opportunity, Brad, to have a headset on and be in the metaverse? I'm just curious.
So I have not had an opportunity to have the headset on. I have tinkered around and actually joined you several months ago in Spatial. Yep. And I was just there last week, actually. I got a little email about some upgrade to the avatar, and I went in and I visited a park, and getting used to it, manipulating the avatar on my keyboard is a little challenging. And I got off that and I said to my wife, I think my next business expense might be this Oculus Quest. Do that. Then I'm going to call you up, and then we're going to have to get in a space together. And
I would love to.
Little training.
I would absolutely love to. So Spatial, for those of you who aren't familiar with Spatial, it's spatial.io. It's one of the four metaverse platforms that I'm recommending professionals use, business owners use, because it's a professional platform where you can design your avatar body to reflect Brad's blue shirt, my red shirt. Mm-hmm. Maybe I've got a jacket and a suit on if I'm a lawyer. It allows you to take your face using your webcam, your phone, uploading a photo from your hard drive, and the AI integrates your face on top of the avatar body. So it feels like Brad and I are actually in the same room, in the same park, in the same art gallery together having a conversation. The ability to access a platform like Spatial with a headset feels as though you're literally standing next to somebody having a conversation. It's unlike anything that I've ever experienced or others who have participated in these platforms have experienced. And, you know, as people become more comfortable with fax machines or email or the internet and started to use these tools, as people become more confident or comfortable with headsets, and headsets become smaller and even less expensive than $300, we're going to see more people using this technology. So I'm glad you brought up Spatial, because that is one of my favorite platforms. And the update that you're talking about is Spatial has added legs onto the bottom of the avatars. And the reason they weren't doing that originally is because of memory storage issues. It takes a lot of megabytes, probably even gigabytes, to develop these avatars in real time and have them come across as looking lifelike in a virtual environment. And because of technology and the speed of processing and some of the things I've already mentioned, what they've done is they added the legs, as have other top platforms. Mm-hmm. So it really does feel like you're in an environment, walking around, interacting with other people, and hopefully closing some business deals. So I'm glad that you were in the platform.
Yeah.
And when you do get the headset, definitely ping me and we'll jump in together.
Okay. Okay. So with all of this new technology on the internet, are there things as business owners that we need to be aware of and think about, be more careful about? The tips you have for business owners?
Well, I do. I think that, you know, we were talking before we went live. I spoke 2 weeks ago at CEX in Phoenix, just a great event, highly recommend it. And the reason Brian Clark and Joe Paluzzi had me there was to talk about the legal aspects of Web3. My presentation also answered the legal aspects for business owners with the metaverse. Some of the things I highlighted, some of the biggest challenges I see clients making, and we're the ones, Brad, as you well know, I know you practiced for like 15 years or something before you got smart and went down another path in life. We get the calls. We know what the problems are, right? And so I think one of the things I'd like all business owners to pay attention to is intellectual property rights. In other words, copyright, trademarks, whatever applies in the real world, using someone else's photo or video, logo, whatever it might be, all of that also applies in the metaverse, on Web3, when you're creating NFTs, and when you're building blockchain and smart contract technologies. You need to respect everybody's intellectual property rights. So that is probably the biggest challenge I see a lot of companies make. What do I mean by that in the metaverse? What I mean, Brad, is if you and I are putting on a conference where we have a beautiful digital conference space that can handle 500 to 1,000 people in the audience, we've got vendor booths on the side that we can sublease out. We can literally set this up in a platform called EngageVR.io in about 10 minutes. Okay, this is not rocket science. This is really cool turnkey templates. And EngageVR.io is another platform that I highly recommend, along with Glue.work and Horizon Workrooms. Those are the four: Spatial, Engage, Glue, and Horizon. I think for professionals, they give the right first impression. What I'm getting at is when we're setting up this conference room, we need to be careful. What do we put on the walls? What do we put on the big screen behind us while we're speaking? What do we put on the vendor booths or allow vendors to come in when it comes to logos and photographs and things like this? So IP plays a big part in everything we're talking about. The second big area is I love to have business owners think about contract law. It's very easy to do things, to tap, to swipe, to click in the Web3 and metaverse platforms. Oftentimes, we agree to do something, we take on new business without that written retainer agreement, without that written contract. It's just fast and easy to do. Maybe there's a FOMO factor, fear of missing out. If I don't agree to do something with this potential client, I may lose this client to somebody else. And so think about always integrating contractual, you know, obligations in your metaverse experiences. I think that's super important. And the last thing is we all need to do our due diligence. When we're going into a platform, when we're building out something in a Web3 environment, do your due diligence. Research the companies and the people that are involved. Brad, you're familiar with these companies. I mentioned to my audience platforms like LexisNexis, Thomson Reuters, where you can actually go in and check millions, if not billions, of data points on people, on cases, and really get a good feel for who you're doing business with. I think that's super important in these environments, more so today than ever before, because one of the things that I didn't talk about with Web3 is in a decentralized environment, especially when you're using DAOs, which are called decentralized autonomous organizations, oftentimes you don't know who else is in that community, is in that organization, is in that metaverse space. I may be engaging with someone who says his name is Brad. I may be interacting with an avatar in a metaverse space who says or purports to be you, Brad, but is it really you? Or am I dealing with one of my client's competitors? And so you need to really be aware of all of the, you know, due diligence steps that we take in the traditional in real life world, especially for the lawyers out there, And you need to double down in these virtual spaces to make sure that you're dealing with who you say you're dealing with, you're doing business with somebody that you want to do business with, and you're protecting your client's confidential information because you're not having inappropriate conversations with the wrong people. So those are the three, I think, highlights or takeaways people need to pay attention to.
Great. Now, I'm guessing that in this decentralized online world, that we also need to be even more diligent about the links that we click on, sharing our passwords, all of those things too.
Oh, you're giving me goosebumps. I mean, those are, so one of the biggest challenges we see, and you just hit on them, is especially in the Discord servers, which is one of the platforms that we see a lot of Web3 information and resources. There's some really great people over in our Discord servers, but we also see some bad actors. And it's very easy for these bad actors to duplicate a website, to share out a bad link. And we have a lot of people, because of FOMO, clicking on these links and, you know, losing all of their NFTs, or giving a bad actor access to their Meta wallet, which is a digital wallet that we use to do a lot of the transactions that, that Brad and I are talking about today in Web3 environments, or taking assets, which are actually digital assets, which are NFTs, from Metaverse number one over into Metaverse number two and Metaverse number three. If you give someone access to your digital wallet, whether you share your passphrase, password, or click on the wrong link, it can be a big problem. And so one of the things that we're paying attention to, Brad, is watching companies, you know, improve the security levels, especially when it comes to human nature. The technology is secure, it's just humans make silly mistakes. And one of the examples I gave in my presentation at CEX, with the permission of Brian Fanzo, was something that happened to Brian. For those of you that, that don't know Brian, he's got a daily NFT podcast, great place to go to learn about NFTs, non-fungible tokens. But that's what happened to Brian. Here's someone that had the highest, I believe, the highest civilian security clearance, you know, during like the Persian Gulf War, or one of the wars. And, yeah, Persian Gulf War. And, you know, someone that was teaching our military how to take safe steps when it comes to digital security. Brian is buying and selling an NFT each day. Something was going on. He had a lot happening. He ended up clicking on the wrong link, which ended up giving access into his digital wallet to some bad actors that stole his NFTs, that stole some digital currency from him before he was able to stop what was happening. And the reason Brian and I wanted to share this example with our audience at CEX is because if it can happen to him, it can happen to me, and it can happen to you. So we all just need to take a deep breath, do your due diligence before clicking on links, before sharing information, and diving too far head first, you know, into the Web3 swimming pool.
Yeah. So for the people who listen to our discussion today and get all excited and decide, oh, I'm going to dive right into this Web3 and Metaverse, are they too late?
No, we're at the very beginning. I honestly feel if you got in next year, you're not going to be too late. Okay. So give yourself, everyone needs to take a deep breath. And there's a lot of things being shared right now on the digital platforms. October 15th of 2021, I shared a tweet, and my tweet said something along the lines that 98% of the NFT projects that we're seeing each and every day are going to fail. The other 2% are going to change the world. Right now, we're in the wild west of Web3. Great people are coming out with awesome ideas, but they don't have the business model to back up those ideas, and so the project fails. Bad people are coming up with some really creative criminal activities, taking advantage, you know, the digital foxes getting into the digital hen houses and taking advantage of people. There's a lot of opportunity, there's a lot of downside. And so what I would encourage everyone to do is learn as much as you can in this space. Okay, the NFT handbook written by Matt Fortnow and Harrison Terry, which I have no personal interest in other than just sharing with everyone in your audience, it's a great book. It will teach you the A to Z's of NFTs. Matt's a lawyer in LA. Q. Harrison Terry is Mark Cuban's community manager. It's a really good book. And chapter 9 has the legal aspects of NFTs. My son and I are, our book, the Metaverse Handbook, looks like it's coming out in June. We're co-writing it together, Brad. And we're going to be sharing with everyone, I think, everything that business owners and professionals need to know to leverage this technology. There's not any coding in the book, but we talk about the things that we've already talked about. We talk about how to communicate in the metaverse platforms. It's one thing to get somebody to click, put on a headset, click, and show up in a metaverse, right? It's another thing to be able to communicate in that metaverse, connect, build rapport, and get deals done. And so we have a whole chapter about how to communicate. And it's what you and I do in trial, Brad. It's the same thing. And I talk about use different spots in the virtual conference room, virtual stage, virtual office as anchor points. Work the room. Don't just stand still with your avatar. Work from the left to the right. Use your hands. When you have a headset on, your avatar will reflect the movement of your hands because you've got hand devices that you're holding. And so I'm animated. If I do this in when I'm speaking in the metaverse, this is what my avatar is doing. Cameras are reflecting my lips, my eyes, my facial movements. It's really an interesting way to kind of connect with somebody. We talk about using metaphors in storytelling and voice inflection when you're having conversations in the metaverse. And I think, for example, one of the takeaways that I see people who are very effectively using these spaces is they're doubling down on their communication skills. They're learning how to tell a good, quick, to the point story using the communication and persuasion tools that I just mentioned. The last chapter we've been working on, which wasn't even on our radar until someone brought it to my attention. And that's why the book didn't come out this month, because we have people suggesting, hey, Mitch, you might want to do a chapter on human resources. Okay, what do I mean by that? Well, we're getting more and more allegations of sexual harassment in the workplace, in the virtual workspaces. And what I mean by that is an employer's avatar inappropriately touching an employee's avatar, or somebody saying something inappropriate in a work environment. And so what we're pointing out in this chapter, and we're not trying to scare anybody out away, we're just trying to like raise awareness of some of the real issues out there, is whatever HR requirements you have in your state or in your region or country, you know, wherever you're watching this video or listening to the interview, understand that human resource laws that apply in real life also apply in the metaverse. And so make sure that you update your policies, you update your employer-employee communication HR manuals to remind your team that what happens in the metaverse, you know, needs to comply with HR rules and requirements. So we're consistently adding things like this to the book, Brad, so that when it's all said and done, somebody has a complete tool that really gives them a snapshot of all the things they need to know when building out their brand, when marketing their business or practice, when taking meetings with clients and customers, or presenting in front of third parties in the virtual spaces. So I think these things are not often thought about, but I think they're very important moving forward.
Wow. So you can actually have a claim for inappropriately touching of an avatar?
It's a very interesting scenario. They're pending right now. There's a case in the UK where not only sexual harassment, but I think there's an allegation of rape. And I don't know all of the details associated with that, but I'll just leave it at that. So what you don't want to have happen is be at the receiving end of a sexual harassment digital lawsuit as a business owner, as an employer. And so I think it's very easy to train your team to handle themselves accordingly, watch what they say, watch their distancing between avatars, watch what you reach out and touch with your avatar when it comes to somebody else's avatar. And just kind of, you know, just move that aside so it's not a risk for your company. Along the same lines, we have a whole chapter on why people in the Web3 environment should do business. And you already know this, but maybe there's some people in your audience that haven't thought about this. Do business in Web3 as a corporation, as a limited liability company. Talk to a lawyer in your state. But the reason you want to do that in addition to separating business liabilities from subjecting your personal assets to business liabilities, is you're also creating additional tax benefits, retirement plan benefits. You're utilizing state and federal tax loopholes to maximize profits and minimize taxes. What you're going to find, especially in the NFT space, is that a lot of people made a lot of money over the last couple of years in the digital space, whether it's with cryptocurrency and NFTs. This year, just the opposite. There's been a huge market adjustment. And so there are a lot of people scrambling to pay short and long-term capital gains taxes on last year's transactions, but they don't have the resources to do it because of what's happened with the market this year. And so having a good CPA, a good tax accountant in your corner to counsel you as to when to do transactions or why purchasing fiat, which is US dollars, it's typical currency in your MetaMask wallet, for example, converting it to cryptocurrency and then using that cryptocurrency to buy NFTs or to purchase digital land or whatever it might be, why what I just mentioned may have 2 to 3 different tax consequences associated with it. So you want to make sure you're up to speed on all the above, especially for the larger companies out there moving forward, because it's only going to get a bit more complicated in these spaces. So that's just another thing I want people to think about. And we touched upon that in the book.
Oh, wow. Can't wait for that book.
I don't want to be a bummer today. I mean, we're talking about a lot of heavy duty stuff.
Sounds, you know, really interesting.
The glass is half full here, everybody. But I just want to make sure everybody understands what glass they're holding in their hand, right?
So on a glass half full kind of topic, are you thinking that these spaces in the metaverse are going to, as time goes on, become more accessible and easier to use?
I do. And ease of use, integration between all the products and services that we talked about, that's what I'm seeing the smart companies, whether they're clients of ours, whether they're friends of mine, whether I'm just watching from a third-party perspective, that's what everyone's working on right now. Yeah, when you build out an office, avatars, a presence in Metaverse A, you want to be able to take that, those digital assets, and that's what they are. Oftentimes, they're NFTs. You want to be able to transfer them easily to Metaverse B, C, D, E, and F. And there are thousands of metaverses out there. We're not even talking about Facebook's Meta right now, just so everyone's clear. Yes, that's one of literally 1,000 or 5,000 metaverses that are available right now. But what we're talking about is the ability to take your digital assets easily and quickly, probably using your phone, to transfer them between platforms. And once that becomes easier to use, what we're going to see, and I want people to, we're going to see an increased use. This is similar to the early web browsers with what we used to call the World Wide Web. I was around back in the day where we were coding and typing in code to access the internet. And then something happened. Somebody came up with a very rudimentary web browser where all of a sudden we could type in a code or click a button and have access to the World Wide Web. And then over the next couple of years, all the big web browsers came along. There was the web browser battle. There were monopoly lawsuits as to what companies could incorporate certain web browsers into their software. But what happened was, is it made the internet available to everyone. With one click, with one tap, you could have access to the internet. What we're seeing today in 2022 with Web3 and the metaverse is we're at that early web browser stage as it might apply to Web3. As soon as the technology and companies make it easier for all of us to tap and participate, it's going to explode. Now, having said that, it's pretty darn easy right now. It's as easy to set up and access one of the four metaverses that I just mentioned as it is to set up and share this StreamYard link and password. Mm-hmm. It's as easy to put on an Oculus Quest 2 headset and using your hands or using the controllers, download the app that I just mentioned within your headset, tap and step into one of these virtual platforms. This is not hard to do. I'm talking next level What I see happening is an easier integration and an easier use for the consumer, which is going to make this space completely explode. So for people involved now, when this explosion takes place in a good way over the next year or two, by positioning yourself now in this space, just like you saw me do with social media, Brad, as a lawyer, you know, 15 years ago, I was an early user and it allowed me and gave me an advantage to build out my brand and to learn these platforms and connect with people all over the world and have certain business opportunities I would not have had if I was a lawyer who was not building out a brand on social. I see the same thing happening right now with Web3 and the metaverse. People that get involved now are positioning themselves for future success, more opportunities, greater communities, and more relationships than ever imagined before. And that's why I'm so excited about this.
So this headset, when you have this headset on and you're in the conference room, when you're actually doing this from your office, are you standing up or are you sitting down and moving your hands and
just both?
I know it's a silly question, but I'm
no, it's not. No, it's not.
To figure out how, because I want to do this. So
yeah, do it. So it's your choice, right? I could be sitting at my desk, logging into the one of my virtual spaces, which I do all the time. I could be standing. If I'm on stage giving a presentation, I've given a couple of large presentations already in the metaverse. And so I like to stand when I'm talking.
Yeah, me too.
And so I'll stand and I'll work. You draw a boundary. In my case, it's about a 20, 30 foot boundary where you can walk around. You can move your avatar without moving your feet. It's really easy to move around in the metaverse. I like to stand when I'm doing that type of stuff. But in Horizon Oculus workrooms, I can log in and create my office space while I'm sitting at my desk. Now, here's the cool part. Because of the keyboard I'm using, I can click a button and I'm sitting at my desk in a virtual space. It's a beautiful office space where I'm able to look down and use my keyboard just as if I'm sitting at my desk, because I am sitting at my desk. It's right in front of me. I'm able to bring up my computer screen within this environment. So I'm able to work on my desktop while we're talking. If you're sitting across the table from me, I can click a button and my desktop can disappear or go down 2/3 of the way so we can see each other. I can project anything that we're doing up on a screen on the far wall that we can look at together. We can stand up and walk over and use the whiteboard or point out things on the screen in this virtual office space. We can change the environment. We can change the table layout from round to a U shape to a presentation shape with multiple rows. But yes, everything we do can be, we can access our keyboard, our videos, our audios from within this space. So it feels like you're sitting at your desk in that particular environment, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, very cool. What about voice commands? Can you access the metaverse with voice?
Great question. So in Oculus, you can set things up where there are voice commands. And one of the things, having said that, most of the controls are done, for example, with when your headset's on, by using a tablet that'll appear in each of these platforms on your left or right wrist, kind of like Star Trek. So I can touch a button and I can mute you or make you sit down or bounce you from the room if you're being disruptive, or we can do whatever we want to do. So oftentimes we're using tablets or our keyboards. One of the things they're working on, and this is going to be a game changer, and it's out right now, but it's not integrated into the four platforms, at least as far as I know, and that is real-time voice translation. So if you're joining me from Paris, you know, and your only language is French, I'm here in Southern California, we're in a conference room, we're having a real-time conversation, you're speaking French, I'm speaking English. We're hearing each other and understanding each other in real time because of the AI. I'm not talking captions. I'm talking about a voice conversation. This technology will probably be perfected and available on the platforms I've mentioned, I'm going to guess within a year and a half or 2 years. And so it opens up business opportunities, not just, you know, locally, but globally, where we're not limited by our lack of ability to speak someone else's language. So when we talk about voice, we're talking about you know, controlling our avatars in the environment. We're talking about communication. I will say that Meta has implemented voice capabilities where you'll be able to say something like, create a digital island, create a virtual sunrise. And so in your space, that will be created. You're not going to have to code to have that done. That apparently is out right now. I don't know if it's in beta. I'm not sure if it's rolled out to the general public, but I read an article where they're already doing that. So voice, as you and I have talked about before over the last 4 or 5 years, voice is being incorporated into the Metaverse and Web3 platforms. And it's just a matter of, you know, how long it's going to take for the technology to catch up to what you and I want to see happen.
Wow. Yeah. So you've mentioned this $300 headset. Are we going to have to invest in thousands of dollars of additional technology in order to take advantage of these platforms?
That's the beautiful thing about it right now. The answer is no.
Yeah.
I mean, the headset is probably the most expensive device. It's sitting over on my couch over there. Otherwise, I'd show it to you. Here's what's going to happen. Everyone's seen the Oculus Quest headset. I think what will eventually happen is it's going to look like this. These are my computer glasses. They're not even reading glasses. It's for the glare. But this is what we're probably going to in the next 5 years. 10 years maybe. Wow. And also the platforms I mentioned, spatial.io, engagevr.io, glue.work, and Horizon Oculus Workrooms. I believe all three of those allow for free access, if I'm not mistaken. I know one of them I'm paying, I think it's $20 or $25 a month, the EngageVR, just to have certain hosting options. So if I'm speaking in front of a large audience, I want to be able to mute everyone or have everyone sit down when I start, bounce somebody if they're not behaving themselves. But I think the maximum expense we're spending, if I'm not mistaken, is $25 a month to access one of those four platforms. And the other three, I believe we're accessing using their free plan. So it's a very inexpensive way to spend an hour or two each week to learn this technology, build out your Web3 and Metaverse skills, and frankly, have fun learning something new.
Yeah, yeah, that sounds great. Okay, a couple times you've mentioned some sort of digital wallet. Can you talk a little bit about the digital wallet and what that is and how we use it?
Sure. So just like we use, some of us use our wallets, some of us older guys still have wallets, but we have our credit cards and maybe a couple of family pictures and business cards in our wallets to purchase goods and services in the real world. There's what are called digital wallets in Web3 in the metaverse. And basically, they're software programs, whether it's an app that you add as a Google Chrome extension, similar to what's called, it's called MetaMask is one that we use. Whether it's a hard wallet that looks something like this, looks like a USB stick that you simply can plug in to your laptop, your desktop, or this one has a, it's made by Ledger, L-E-D-G-E-R. It has a Bluetooth connection so that I can crank this up, connect it to my phone. I don't have to plug it into anything. And it allows me to do everything that this digital wallet, this is called a cold wallet because it's not connected to the internet. It's a lot safer than a plug-in to a browser or many of the other digital wallets because it's removed from the internet connection. It's what we use to purchase digital currency like Bitcoin and Ethereum. It's what we use to help store our NFTs and keep track of our NFTs. It's what we use to do transactions between somebody in real life and somebody in the metaverse. It's just a device. It's a conduit that between our real lives and the Web3 environments. They're not complicated to use. They're as easy to use as an email program. They're as easy to use as, you know, clicking on a Chrome browser and going into StreamYard, for example. It's just a new tool that I think is going to also complement this broad change that we've been talking about. Because when you download a digital wallet, it's an app onto your smartphone, what happens is it allows you to access all the platforms using digital currency, doing your Web3 transactions that we talked about. It's your key to Web3. Maybe that's a great way of looking at it. It's your key to Web3. I do believe, Brad, digital wallets are going to be much more than that. Okay. I think it's something that everyone's going to be using to do everyday in real life transactions, similar to Apple Wallet. If you have Apple Wallet, we touch a button, put it up next to a screen at Starbucks, and we can purchase our morning coffee or bagel. Digital wallets are allowing us to do the same thing, but there's so much more. They're so much more powerful. And so I do see it as being our individual and or business keys to the real world and to the digital world, especially when it comes to the things that we've talked about.
Very interesting.
Yeah. Interesting stuff.
Yeah. And so one of the other things that you mentioned earlier that struck a chord with me was this term smart contract.
Smart contracts. Exactly. Yeah.
Can you talk about that a little?
Well, I'm not a coder, and I'm one of those guys where when I flip the switch to the lights in my office and they come on overhead, that's all I want to know. That's how I turn the lights on. I don't care about where the electricity is. Well, I do care about the environment, but technically speaking, how it's generated, how it's wired to my home, you know, dozens of miles away from the electric company. I don't, you know, how all this stuff works, I'm not really sure. I just know when I flip the light, it comes on. Okay, smart contracts are, for me, it's the same thing. It's a tool, it's a device, it's code that when something happens, then something else happens automatically, whether it's one thing or 10 million thing on the blockchain. It's a secure transaction. It's available for public viewing. It's secure when done correctly, but it allows us to transact business, in my world, transact business in a more efficient and faster way. So for example, when a new client comes into the office and we file a lawsuit, what I see happening in the not too distant future is that lawsuit, instead of it being uploaded and filed electronically with the court, I see it being uploaded automatically, instantly being converted into a non-fungible token, into an NFT, NFT being placed on the blockchain, and smart contract technology will then steer and direct that new case through our court system automatically. In other words, whether it's hearings that are set, whether it's deadlines and filing dates, whether it's conflict of interest checks, whether it's finding an open courtroom to try a case or hold a mediation, all of this will be handled through the programming on this smart contract so that the client and the lawyer or all the lawyers in the case, the judge, the clerk staff, they don't have to worry about the details. It's going to be processed automatically. Excuse me. This technology is already here. It's just a matter of third parties like the court adopting this technology. So that's one way smart contracts can be used. Another way is with the purchase and sale of real estate. What we're seeing are, instead of written escrow agreements and written titles and deeds of trust and things like this, all of this at the time of a purchase or a sale using smart contracts can be incorporated into the blockchain. And everything is recorded, it's secure, complements the buying and selling process without the need for paperwork, without the need to go down to the recorder's office, without the need to have to make sure that other people aren't filing fraudulent titles to try to steal your property from you. So everything is documented and recorded on these digital platforms, which is the blockchain. And then the smart contract, the brains behind what happens with that particular deed, with that particular lawsuit, all of that's controlled through smart contract technology. And so, you know, this is happening right now, and it's only going to be used more and more as companies figure out how to use it, as consumers become more comfortable with taking advantage and leveraging this technology. And I'm excited about it. As soon as they get it to the point where it's just like you and I flipping the switch to turn on the lights, to do A, B, and C on the blockchain using smart contracts, everything's going to change.
Yeah. Yeah. So a real estate deal done on the blockchain, if there's a dispute down the road, there's still going to be an opportunity to access those documents and show your paper trail and all of that.
More so because it's a public blockchain. Every single transaction is recorded. Every single transaction can be reviewed. You don't have to worry about somebody fraudulently signing a deed of trust, hiding it in their safety deposit box for 20 years, coming up after the fact when Uncle Harry dies, stepping into the probate process with this fraudulent deed. And now the dispute is that Uncle Harry's signature on the deed? No, everything is public. Everything is easily accessible. And when you have AI evaluating the validity of whatever that particular transaction is, it really, and I'm talking about within milliseconds as opposed to decades of time, it creates a more efficient and effective and trustworthy business scenario. And so I think lawyers that embrace this technology and complement everything I just said with third-party services. In other words, if we're using blockchain technology with smart contracts, that's great. Let's have an underlying written agreement between the parties, specifically delineating that that's what we're doing. Okay. And so everyone's on the same page. That's where lawyers are still valuable assets in these environments. We're using traditional legal approaches to embrace the blockchain and smart contracts to help make the client experience faster, easier, and less expensive. And I think that's a business model that wins every single time.
So what's the first thing that a business owner needs to do to sort of plant their flag and take advantage of Web3 in the metaverse today?
There are two things I would suggest. I would suggest, when you have a chance, check out the platforms that we just talked about. Set up a free account and play around with these platforms. Get an Oculus Quest 2. And after you set up your accounts in these platforms on your laptop, your desktop, or your phone, you're going to put your Oculus on and you're going to download the app to Spatial, Engage, to Horizon Workrooms, to Glue.Work. And you download those within your Oculus. You log in using your same username and password. And now you're in these spaces using your virtual headset. Okay, that's the first step. And just have fun and get a feel for how these work. Having said that, what I would suggest is I've got a LinkedIn newsletter and it's focused on Web3 business and the law. The first five editions of my LinkedIn newsletter, Brad, I dived deep into if I'm a business owner and I want to start embracing Web3 and the metaverses, here are the things you need to do. Okay, it's a non-technical newsletter issues. And I think the first five issues of my newsletter will help everyone learn how to do everything we just said, where I talk about click on this button, go over and then try this template within Spatial so you can see what it's like to stand in an outdoor amphitheater in Sedona, Arizona, and be able to give a presentation to 30 people. Here's the template you want to click on. I just really break it down. If you're a lawyer and you want a virtual courtroom where you literally walk into a courtroom, you've got the jury box to your right, the judge is sitting in front of you, you've got the witness box to your left, you've got counsel table. These templates are available. And so in Engage, I share in one of my newsletters how to access this courtroom so that lawyers can take their clients into these spaces and have them sit in the jury box and have them sit on the witness stand and maybe even have them sit where the judge sits so that get an idea of what the judge is looking at during the trial. So we break all that down. And I think those would be the first two steps that I take so that you can get familiar with what we're talking about. I think for me to tell someone, for you and I to talk about Web3 and the metaverse is kind of like trying to give somebody a haircut over the telephone. It's impossible to do. And so you actually have to sit in that digital chair and you have to just let it happen and experience it. And I think once people do, they'll be as excited as I am about these new opportunities, and hopefully you are too.
Absolutely. Well, I can also highly recommend that LinkedIn newsletter. And though I can't confirm or deny, it's possible that some of the questions that I've asked you today came from me reading some of those newsletters. But
interesting. I like that.
That there's a possibility there. And while we're on that topic, since the minute we get done today, I'm going online to buy that Oculus Quest 2.
Good.
Asking for a friend, any like people who might be sensitive to motion sickness and things like that, is that an issue with that headset in these rooms in the metaverse?
It's not an issue in the spaces I just mentioned, but yes, it's an issue when you're gaming in the metaverse. So
right.
I'm not using these platforms for gaming. It's just not my thing. If I have an hour to spend, I'm going to go for a run or a paddleboard. That's just me. I'm old enough now where every single day on this planet, I want to appreciate, I want to embrace, and that's just the way I'm rolling right now. Another day on the top side of the grass is a good day for me. Having said that, when my son Garrett is home and we jump on our headsets together, we'll jump into some games just to bond and hang out together. And yeah, I get a little queasy, right? I get a little dizzy. It's just a weird feeling being on a roller coaster, going through the Grand Canyon with dinosaurs chasing you, you know, and the wind blowing in your face. And I don't like that stuff, but everything else that we talked about, that's not an issue. Excuse me. Sorry about that, Brad.
No problem.
That's not an issue or a factor. And neither are incoming phone calls when you're in the metaverse. And you know what's kind of cool, Brad, is when you put these headsets up on, you're going to be building out your Oculus Quest 2 environment. You'll be in your own room and you'll have a dashboard. It's pretty amazing. What you're going to find is when you're in Oculus, you can connect your web browser. So you can check your email, you can jump on Facebook or Twitter or your Discord. Anything that you can do sitting at your desk, you can do with your Oculus on. So when I have my Oculus on, I'm actually checking emails and text messages and all the different platforms that we're talking to. I actually did a LinkedIn Live audio, which I'm jumping on in 30 minutes today, which is kind of cool. I'm all in on LinkedIn Live. But I did it from within my conference room in my virtual space. So it's my avatar. I've got my headset on, but I was able to jump in and participate on LinkedIn Live on a huge screen at the end of the conference room. So even though you're in these spaces, you can still access most of your other applications if you want to, right?
Right.
And there's no dizziness involved. I think I'm more dizzy right now sitting in my chair than I am when I'm in the space doing the things I just discussed.
All right, like I said, just asking for a friend.
I'm with you. I have the same issue.
Okay, so you're recently back from CEX, Creator Economy Expo. Can you give us the inside scoop on something big you learned there?
Inside scoop is pay attention to everything Brad and I just talked about, because this is game-changing stuff. And I was so blown away and impressed by the speakers, by the conversations, the private conversations that I had with people that were there, both attending and speaking, that what's interesting, Brad, is the most of the videos, if not all the videos, are available now for free. Joe and Brian are making them available, so you might want to include the link. I can send it to you if you want. But what you're going to see, for example, in the opening keynote, a gentleman spoke about all the different ways that businesses can use and are using NFTs, non-fungible tokens, right now in today's world. And it was a fantastic presentation. It opened my eyes to some new ways that we can use NFTs and the blockchain and smart contracts when doing business on an everyday business. Like, for example, when a new client comes into our office, if they're a technology client, Brad, right now, we will sign them up, but we also give them an NFT. That NFT, we send it, we airdrop it to their phone, or we'll send it to them, and it gives them access to clicking a private link that's password protected to their portion of our CRM, to their clients, their files, their calendars. It gives them access to weekly client presentations that I do do Q&A with my clients in different sectors of business that we represent. It gives them access to any annual events that we put on at discounted or free access, depending on what the event is, all through this digital NFT. right now, this is new, and not a lot of clients are using these because it's brand new to everyone. But I think this is something that every client will be using. But here's the part that people are missing out on. These clients that meet me in the metaverse or that receive our NFT, whether they're using them or not, they're telling their family, their friends, their business associates, yeah, I just met with my lawyer in his virtual office, or my lawyer just airdropped me an NFT. It creates branding, marketing, and conversation opportunities for our clients to have with third parties. That's a beautiful thing. When you've got your client talking about their unique experience with your law firm or your marketing agency or whatever you do for a living, that's a win right now. And then if you can double down and compliment on top of it and continue the conversation and the experience in the different Web3 and virtual platforms, I think that's where the magic happens. So circling back to the beginning of the show, that's what we're doing right now. Yeah. I'm so excited about this, Brad, that 2 months ago, my son just graduated from the University of Southern California Marshall School of Business. So we're very proud of Garrett. He worked very hard to get into USC, and it's been a crazy 4 years with COVID and remote learning and everything else. But before he graduated 2 weeks ago, 2 months ago, we created a company. It's called Maneuver. And this company helps traditional businesses transition or maneuver into the Web3 and metaverse spaces. Brad, the reason Garrett and I are doing this together is because he and his friends, they're Gen Z, 22 years old, right? None of them care about social media. I mean, I don't want to be a bummer for anybody, but they just don't really care. I mean, they like communicating on Instagram and private messaging on Snap, but other than that, they're doing other things. They're all in on Web3. They're all in on the metaverse. This is something where they're so involved in it that they meet on their own on Sundays and have conversations about the real estate industry in Web3 in the metaverse, or how you can use this technology for mental health reasons. This is something that Gen Z is very, very interested in. And so Garrett and I are using Maneuver, and I'm just having a ball working with him. I've spoken more with Garrett in the last 3 months than I have over the last 4 years, you know, typical college, right? Yeah. So as a dad, I'm digging it from that perspective. But from a business standpoint, he went with us to CEX, and he got a chance to meet with some movers and shakers in the industry and have private one-on-one conversations. And the reality is, this is the next step to doing business, to delivering our products and services on a global basis. And yes, we're just getting started. Yes, even next year, I think if you come in, you're just getting started. But I think moving forward 4 to 5 years from now, 10 years from now, this is going to be the norm. And so if this is going to be the norm in 5 or 10 years, you know, my thought process is, why not start today? Why not start taking baby steps, using the resources that Brad has shared with everyone during this podcast and live video, and start to learn the basics of what we're talking about? If it was complicated, I wouldn't be doing it, everyone, okay? It's not complicated, it's just new. And so learning something new each and every day, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, I think when you look back a year from now, you'll be one of the experts in this field as Web3 and the metaverse applies to your business, to your profession, to your occupation. And niching down with these technologies to what you do, I think that's the key to success. I think it's the key to happiness. And it's the key to learning how to embrace all this technology to get better results for your customers and clients.
Great. Well, Mitch, I know that you have a hard stop and you have to run. All of the things that you talked about today, I'm going to put in the show notes so that there's links and easy ways for people to get there. But I just got to ask you one last thing.
Sure.
About your law practice. And that is that you practice law with your wife. Is that correct?
I do, when she lets me. We met in law school, and she's she's the senior partner, and it's the best thing that's ever happened to me.
Okay. Well, I just want to say from personal experience, because my wife is a paralegal, and way back in the day, she worked with me for one weekend when I was struggling and needed some help with some filing. And she came in and she redid my whole filing system. And on Monday, I went to look for a file and I couldn't find anything. And when I called her and I said, "What's up?" She said, "Well, I set it up in a way that it works for me. And I'm like, you have a job. You're working in a law firm. I need this to work for me. And I had to fire her. We worked for one weekend. So,
oh my goodness.
The fact that you've been working with your wife since 1986,
I commend you. She came in 88 after we got married. She gave notice. We took our honeymoon. We won our trip on the Rick D's radio show. We didn't have any money back then and went back east to Cape Cod and DC for our honeymoon and came back and she started with me and the rest is history. We've been going strong ever since. And, you know, it's interesting because I grew up on a ranch in Tucson, Brad, where my mom and dad worked together. Oh. So I watched them work together. She grew up with her mom and dad working together and building a dairy distributorship together. So for us, it was very natural. It's like, why don't I want to have lunch each day with Lisa? Or little secret just between you and me, because I know no one's listening. On Thursdays, we used to block our calendar off, and we will once COVID settles down a little bit more. Uh-huh. We'd go out to lunch and see a movie each Thursday afternoon. Kind of like our date time, especially when the kids were young and grandma and grandpa were watching them. And so I can't imagine doing it any other way, but, you know, major respect, it's not for everyone. And, but having a partner in a law firm that you can trust, having a partner that's probably, you know, one of the best trial lawyers I've ever come across in my life, having a partner that, appreciates, and Brad, you'll remember this. You're stressed out getting ready for a big hearing or getting ready to do your opening statement. You don't want to talk to anybody. You're not the nicest person in the world at 8 o'clock at night when you know you still have five more hours of work. Right. Being, you know, married to somebody and working with someone that understands that and gives you, you know, your space and you can give them their space when they're going through the same thing. That's pretty cool. And so for us, it really worked out. On the other side of the coin, when you do have that occasional argument first thing in the morning, it can make for a long day at the law firm. So normally when that happens, one of us will go running, paddle boarding, or just call in sick, and the sun comes up the next day and everybody's happy again.
Yeah, well, I will say, having my wife as a paralegal, I got a lot of those benefits of her understanding what I was going through and the like. And to be honest, with COVID and her working at home the last year, we have had the opportunity to have lunch on a few days and sneak away for a cocktail late in the afternoon in our backyard or something like that.
So late in the afternoon, are we talking 11 o'clock in the morning?
No, maybe two.
Has that changed a little bit over the last 2 years?
Maybe two in the afternoon is late now.
Oh, man. Hey, it's been so good to see you.
Oh, it's been great to see you. Real quick, where do you want people to find you? JacksonandWilson.com. Is that a good place to start?
That's our law firm and a great place to start if anyone needs legal assistance or has a legal question. I think for what we've been talking about, Web3, Metaverse, a lot of technology and social media stuff, my blog, MitchJackson.com, is the place to go to start the digital dance. So MitchJackson.com.
Great. I'll put that in the show notes too. Mitch, thanks so much. I appreciate all your time. I really appreciate it. This was so interesting. I can't wait to go buy my Oculus Quest right now when we get off.
When you do, ping me and I'll see you in the metaverse.
Okay. Thanks, Mitch.
All right, Brad. Take care. Bye-bye. Yeah.